Welcome back. Slipping a bit more for the market, 0.5% down now for the frontliners, and it's just unrelenting for the rupee. It's not like it's in a free fall, but it is giving up some ground, as you can see. 58.85 actually the last time I checked, so it's moving around in a very, very small band, but the direction, as you can see, is not comfortable. Tonight is going to be defining for many emerging markets, but the last couple of weeks have seen quite a bit of pressure with regards to flows, and that's what it boils down to. Deborah Furr of ETFG GI joins in from the sidelines of the Motilal Oswal EDF conclave to talk about what the money's been up to. Deborah, good morning. Thank you for joining in. Just walk us through what your own observation has been in terms of trends through the May to June period with regards to ETFs, both on debt and equity, and whether there have been very sharp outflows and it looks like there is the risk of more.
Good morning. So based on a report we recently published looking at flows globally, what we've seen is we've actually had record inflows through global ETFs. So this year, we've seen $108 billion of net new money going into ETFs and ETPs globally. Compared to last year at this time, it was just $81 billion. The money primarily is going into U.S. equities. Money has been going into Japan, although that did stop quite recently because I think many investors are concerned about whether the economic reforms in Japan are actually going to come through the way many had expected. There's also a concern about QE programs easing, but the U.S. market has taken in about $62 billion of net new money. We've seen investors looking for income and yield, so high dividend yielding benchmarks have also been appealing. The flows into emerging market equities have actually been negative $5.2 billion. We've seen $19 billion going into fixed income exposure, mostly into short-term exposure, high yield, and a little bit of governments. We've also seen that the commodity space has been under a lot of pressure. So like your earlier speaker was mentioning, commodities, especially precious metals, have seen outflows of $24 billion year to date, and that's primarily been in gold and a bit in silver. So the trends in ETFs really represent what smart investors are doing, because the users of ETFs are asset managers globally, their pension funds, sovereign wealth funds, financial advisors, as well as retail. So it's a very democratic product that investors use to tactically adjust their allocations. They also use ETFs for long-term core holdings. So net, we're seeing money staying in ETFs, but they are tactically adjusting based on political and economic changes that are happening in the market. And I think, you know, the concern about China and a hard landing is impacting investors' view on how much money they want to overall have in emerging markets.
Deborah, morning. From your discussions with the whole universe of ETF managers or end investors, does it appear to you that the trend that you described just now of US and Japan taking in most of the money and emerging markets losing it, could it get more accentuated or pronounced going forward?
Well, I think it really depends on the news coming out, because clearly, you know, things are changing almost daily. I think the concern about Europe has really declined over the past couple of months. So when we saw a concern about Europe, people were taking money out of Europe and reallocating it to other markets. So that's the beauty of ETFs. Anytime during the trading day, you are able to reallocate your assets if you feel that's an appropriate thing to do. So I would say, you know, investors are looking to see what is going to happen with QE programs in various countries, what is going to happen in Japan, and whether the economic changes are really going to be long-term beneficial. I think what we do find is for many emerging markets in Japan, when investors want to allocate, they typically do so through ETFs. And the reason for that is many investors don't have foreign investor status to invest directly in mainland China, Korea, Taiwan, or even India for that case. And so using an ETF allows you to invest without having to apply for special status. And the other challenge is for many investors, it's hard to find active funds or individually pick stocks and bonds that are going to do better than the benchmark. So using an ETF that gives you the index, if you can get your asset allocation right, you can generate alpha through asset allocation, as opposed to just trying to pick stocks or bonds or find an active fund that's going to beat the benchmark.
The general perception in India, at least, is that the ETF flows tend to be quite volatile. And we classify it almost in the hot money category. But is that too simplistic an assessment of the stickiness of ETF money?
It definitely is. I think, you know, if you look at a very small segment of the market, looking at just, say, ETFs providing exposure to India, you might view that as being a bit more volatile because it is reacting to investors' sentiment towards India. And clearly, many investors use ETFs to gain exposure and when they feel they want to redeploy. So you're looking at a very small slice because ETF assets today globally are $2.14 trillion. The assets directly in funds tracking India are just $5.6 billion, so a very small percent of the overall assets. And when we look at the holding periods, for many investors, they are now holding their ETF allocations for more than a year. So it's not just buy and trade very quickly in a number of days. For many investors, they are core strategic investments for the investors using ETFs. So whether that's a sovereign wealth fund, a pension fund, an asset manager, a financial advisor in a model portfolio, or an end retail investor, many are using things on a longer term basis.
What exactly is your observation though on what's happened with the debt side and for some of these emerging market bond markets, Deborah, because that's really where the pressure has been felt this last month, as also on emerging market currencies? Are you getting the sense that there is deep redemption pressure there still, or are people just holding extremely high cash levels as a safety net of sorts?
Well, I think many investors are still sitting on a lot of cash. I think that we've seen that the economic and political uncertainty across the markets for a number of years now has caused many people to have pretty high cash levels. They have put a bit of money to work. I think when you look at emerging markets on the debt side, fixed income ETFs have only been around since early 2000, where equity ETFs have been around since 1990. So the array of products on the debt side is smaller, and we've seen that that's a developing area, but the amount of assets in fixed income ETFs is much smaller than what we see in equities. So equity ETFs account for about 70% of all assets. There have been flows out of emerging market debt, but what I would say is many investors are holding on to some allocation because using the ETF is an easy way to get that emerging market debt exposure. There's not a lot of other ways for them to easily do so. So many investors are holding on to that as part of their model portfolio and not totally going into cash. And that is typically the position you see, that some people will reallocate, others will hold on to some allocation because clearly it is part of their long-term strategic asset allocation.
Appreciate you joining in today, Deborah. I have a good conference over there. That's some thoughts on what's been happening with flows into emerging markets like India. But keeping with that conversation and how it ties in with commodities, Jonathan Barrett joins.